Make us among those, inshallah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I advise you as well as I advise myself, with that what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have commanded in the Quran, or you have believed, have consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, have taqwa of Allah, and say that only which is upright and correct and truthful. Allah, if you do so, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will fix your affairs, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive all your sins, and whoever obeys Allah and obeys the Messenger, then that is the true winner. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among those, inshaAllah. So brothers and sisters, a quick reminder, inshaAllah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We've came from Ramadan, from a great season that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have blessed us to witness, the month of the Quran. We are coming to another beautiful season, that of Hajj. Both are great reminders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the struggle that we face with this dunya in order for us to be closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But it is important to understand that in order for us to have a great relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have to have a great relationship with His book, the Quran. There is first, before I go into the explanation, there's an ayah, a verse in the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the complaint about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, after a'udhu billahi as-sami'i al-'alim min ash-shaytan ar-rajim, after seeking refuge by Allah, the all-hearing, the all-seeing from shaytan and curse, وقال الرسول يا رب إن قوم اتخذوا هذا القرآن مهجورا. And the messenger have said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used actually the past tense, although it's simply futuristic. This is in the hereafter, in the day of Qiyamah. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the past tense, which is a style that we use in the Arabic grammar, to show that it's going to happen no matter what. This is definite, for sure. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is going to complain and say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Rabbi, O my Lord, إِنَّ قَوْمِ اتَّخَذُوا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ مَهْجُورًا. My people have actually chosen the Qur'an to be an object of abandonment. The people have pretty much abandoned the Qur'an. My people have chosen the Qur'an to be an object of hijrah. We should be all familiar with the word hijrah, which is migration. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam left from Mecca to Medina, we use the word hijrah for that. When you leave something behind completely, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used that complaint with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the day of judgment concerning the Quran. So this surah, so the Quran was actually revealed in Mecca. So the ayat were actually talking about the disbelievers in Mecca and how they completely rejected the Quran. They did not want to listen to it, they did not want to adhere to it, they did not want to follow it. They want nothing to do with the Quran whatsoever. They even warned the people, don't listen to it. They spoke people so much to the point where they were actually put cotton in their ears to make sure that they don't hear any of the Quran even by mistake. But we have to understand that that's not the only way to abandon the Quran. So our scholars have actually categorized different styles or different categories of hijrah, of abandoning the Quran. The first of which is to completely abandon it, like the Kuffar of Quraysh, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from that. To have no relationship with it. You don't want it, you don't want to follow it, you don't want to hear it, you want nothing to do with the Quran. But there are different kinds, like we said, of abandonment that are lesser than that. And I would like to use, as an example, to kind of get that in perspective, if you use a couple, a husband and wife, and their relationship, if they completely separate from each other, have no actual, you know, connection whatsoever, physically or any kind of way, then we'll see that they completely have no relationship, like the kuffar with the Quran. But a person, for example, a husband can be in the house, but can not be there at the same time. You understand what I mean? Can be there physically, but emotionally he's unavailable, right? Emotionally he's unavailable. Maybe watching TV, on, you know, games, or whatever it is, but he's completely absent from the household, from the children, from the wife. He's absent-minded. Physically he's there. Is that a correct or good relationship? Of course not. And the same thing can be done with the Quran. A person can have the book itself or the app even in their phone, have it in their presence, but have no relationship with the Quran whatsoever. Right? Or even have the relationship where you recite the Quran, but no connection whatsoever to it. That's a dysfunctional relationship with the Quran, just like the dysfunctional relationship with the husband. So that is a way of abandoning the Quran that we really have to be careful of. A different category beneath that or under that For example, we go again to the husband. The husband can actually be there and actually interact with his wife and with his children, but can be very condescending. He treats them bad. We treat them that they're lower. Or I'll treat you whenever I need something from you, I'll treat you well. Whenever I don't get nothing out of it, then the hell with you. That kind of relationship. Again, it's dysfunctional. And the same thing can be done with the Quran. Where a person can, like I said, can be a person who reads the Quran and recites the Quran, but doesn't want to apply it. Only when it's convenient. If it's easy, this is easy going, this goes along with my culture, I practice it. This is difficult, I'm not ready for this, I don't like it, I don't agree with it, I put it to the side. Being condescending with the Quran in that way is very tragic. Right? And this is something that we also have to be aware of. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all from that, inshallah. So there are different kinds of abandonment that we have to examine our relationship with the Quran. How often do I recite the Quran? How much do I understand from the Quran? How much do I practice from the Quran? Did I have that strong relationship with the Quran in Ramadan and completely abandon it after? Or did I continue with that? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in some of the hadith mentioned, like for example in Tabari, and also mentioned by Abu Zakariya al-Ansari in al-Shuruh, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that I've looked at the sins of my ummah and have seen nothing greater than a person who have memorized something from the Quran and then forgotten it. There's no greater sin than the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in this hadith than a person who gets familiar with the Quran and then get unfamiliar again with the Quran. So that's the great sin that we have to be careful of. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all. And if we look at and examine the relationship the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had with the Quran, it was truly amazing. And we can see how the companions also grew from that and gained from that. So we look at, for example, Hafsa radiallahu anha wa Allah, the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our mother, Hafsa. She said in one of her hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he used to read a surah, you would actually think it's longer than a bigger surah. What does she mean? She means that if he recites sallallahu alayhi wa sallam a surah, for example, a surah that's about a half a page, it would sound like he's reading a surah that's over a page long. Because he's taking his time with the sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You know how in Ramadan, those of us who went to Taraweeh, for example, or Qiyam, most of the time the Qari recites very fast, trying to finish the Quran, right? Or even when we recite ourselves in the Salah, we rush through the Quran, trying to finish it really fast. Sometimes we're not even sure if we said the entire words. But look at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and how he reads the Quran. She says, said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would read it and it would sound much, much longer than a bigger surah. Because he would take his time with the sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He would allow it to serenade him, to touch his heart, to go past his throat, to go into his mind, to affect him immediately. And we can see that in many, many ahadith. For example, we look at Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu wa Allah. Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman, one of the important Sahabis, companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was dubbed Sahibu Surri Rasulillah, the keeper of the secrets of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said in hadith that I went one night with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he got up to pray and I stood up with him. And he said the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this is in Tahajjud, not in Ramadan. So he said the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started to recite from Surah Al-Baqarah. And he kept reading and reading, and I thought to myself, he's going to get to ayah number 100 and then we're going to make rukun. It's been going on for a while now. So he said the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam got to ayah number 100 and continued going. So he said he kept going and kept going. I said to myself, maybe he will finish Surah Al-Baqarah. We're talking about the same rak'ah, by the way. He did not make rukun yet. He will finish Surah Al-Baqarah and then we'll make rukun. You know that feeling when you know the surah that the imam is reciting and you're like, oh, I know when this is going to end, right? This is the feeling that Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu had with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Oh, he's going to finish Surah Al-Baqarah. I know the surah, he's going to finish it, then we'll go on to rukun. But he said the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam finished the entire surah and then started to read Surah Al-Nisa. So Surah Al-Baqarah is how long? But we're talking about 2.5 juz. And then went into Surah Al-Nisa after that, in the same rak'ah. He finished Surah Al-Nisa, he said, I said to myself, we're going to finish Surah Al-Nisa, and then we're going to make a report finally. He finished Surah Al-Nisa, and the Prophet went back and started Al-Imran. and finish the entire surah and then make ruku. We talk about the three longest surahs in the Quran all in one rak'ah. 5.5 ajza, juzus of the Quran. Talking over 250 pages of the Quran. How do you think the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam read it? You would think 5.5 juzus, that's a long time, right? We need to rush through it. 1 hour of tarawih by itself is a leg killer. So 5.5 juzus, that takes a lot of song, right? Hudhayf ibn al-Yaman said the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam kana yaqra'uhu mursala. He used to recite it very slow. So not only did he recite all of that in one rak'ah, he recited it sallallahu alaihi wasallam very slow, as his usual. Aisha radiallahu anha said another hadith, said the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he used to read the Quran, the person sitting next to him can count the letters as he go. That's how slow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to recite the Quran. Not only that, continue the hadith. Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu arda said the Prophet read all of that in one rak'ah. And he recited it slow, and every single time. كلما مر بآية فيها سؤال سأل وكلما مر بآية استعاذة استعاذ وكلما مر بآية تسبيح سبح. Whenever the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم come across an ayah in that rak'ah that tells him to ask Allah for something, he will stop and ask Allah for it. Whenever he comes across an ayah that mentions the tasbih of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will pause the recitation and make tasbih of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whenever there's an ayah of isti'ab of seeking refuge by Allah, he will stop and make isti'ab. Imagine how much the Prophet ﷺ was invested in that recitation. As an example, we all should be familiar with Surah Al-A'la. The first ayah, سَبِّحِ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ الْأَعْلَى. Glorify your Lord the Most High. It's a command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to do it and to say it. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would actually stop and say Subhana Rabbi al-A'la and then continue reading. Whenever the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would come across a question, for example in Surah At-Teen, we all again should be familiar, it's a small surah. It ends with what? It ends, أَلَيْسَ اللَّهُ بِأَحْكَمِ الْحَاكِمِينَ. Isn't Allah the most wise of those who are wise? It's a question from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to pause and say, بَلَى وَأَنَا عَلَى ذَلِكَ مِنَ الشَّاهِدِينَ. Yes, indeed you are, and I'm a witness for that. And then we'll continue sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with his recitation. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to interact with the Quran. He will recite it slow, allow it to actually serenade and enter into his heart and mind. And then react to it sallallahu alayhi wa sallam immediately. Immediately. He would not expect the effect to come later. You don't read the Quran to become a better person later. You want to become a better person as you are reading the Quran. And if you're not feeling the Quran in that way, then you're not reading the Quran properly as it should be. So we all should examine our relationship with the Quran. We should all look into the example of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and how he used to read the Quran, how he used to react to the Quran, and how he allowed the Quran to affect him. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to fulfill our promise of the Quran. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. سيدنا ما في سبيل مس ما في سبيل. الحمد لله حمدا طيبا مباركا فيه ملء السماوات والأرض ومنه ما بينهما ومنه ما شاء من شيء بعد. اللهم صل وسلم على سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلاة ترضيك وترضيه وترضى بها عنا. We express that in our praise and our gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in an abundance that will fill the heavens, the earth, anything between them, and anything that He wills subhanahu wa ta'ala beyond that. And we send our salutations and our prayers upon our beloved and an example, our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family and companions, in a way that is pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is pleasing to our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that will gain us all the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brothers and sisters, again, I would like to go through another hadith before we go into the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, of how a person should, what kind of attitude should we have while reading the Quran. There's a hadith with Aisha radiallahu anha wa Allah's mentioned in Bukhari. So she said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was with me in one of my nights. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had many wives, and he divided the nights between them. So at that night of Aisha radiallahu anha wa Allah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam turned to her and said, دَرِينِ يَتَعَبَدُ رَبِّي. Allow me to go worship my Lord. And before we even continue with that hadith, Because I know we usually go look and zero in on the one thing we want to take out of the hadith, which is a disservice to the hadith. We want to take it in its totality. So when you read a hadith like this, you want to look at the beautiful relationship between the Prophet and Aisha, how the Prophet didn't have to ask for permission to go worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But nonetheless, he did. He asked her for permission to go and pray. Pretty much saying what? I know you have needs. I know these are your rights. So would you allow me to go to do that? Look at that beauty, subhanAllah. And Aisha radiallahu anha reciprocated that. So she said, Wallahi inni la uhibbukuma. I swear by Allah, I love to be next to you and near you. Right? Walakinni uhibbu ma yusrifu. But I love more that what makes you happy. So meaning what? Go and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at this, the beautiful interaction that they have and how they go about their day. So the Prophet ﷺ gets up, and this is late at night, by the way. So the Prophet ﷺ gets up, and he starts to make salah. And she said, radiallahu anha wa taha, I know the Prophet ﷺ started to repeat certain ayat, and start repeating over and over again, and cry until his beard got wet, until his clothes got wet. And he kept repeating it and crying it until there is a puddle of tears where he was standing, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Until Fajr came up, and the Prophet ﷺ was in that state. Reading the same ayat in salah and crying, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Bilal radiallahu anhu wa ta'ala came to call him for Fajr, as was his usual. Bilal radiallahu anhu wa ta'ala would call the adhan, and then when the time is for the iqamah, he used to come to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and actually get him with him, physically. So when Bilal radiallahu anhu wa ta'ala came in this time, he saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sitting down and crying. So he said, Ya Rasulullah, atabki, wa qad ghafara Allahu laka ma taqaddama min dhanbika wa ma ta'akhkhara. O Messenger of Allah, you cry like this, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgiving you your past and future sins? And the Prophet ﷺ replied with that famous statement that we usually quote, where he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَفَلَا أَكُونَ عَبْدًا شَكُورًا. Should I not be a very grateful servant to Allah then? But then he continued, it doesn't stop there. The Prophet ﷺ said then, أُنزِلَتْ عَلَيْهَا اللَّيْلَةَ. Tonight I have received some ayat. وَيْلٌ لِمَنْ قَرَأَهَا وَلَمْ يَتَدَبَّرَهَا. Severe punishment and severe warning for those who read it and not ponder its meaning and not think about its meaning. And then the Prophet ﷺ recited the 10 last ayat of Surah Al Imran, Inna fi khalqi as-samawati wal-ardi wa-ikhtilafi al-layli wan-nahari la-ayatin lil al-albab. That there is in the creation of the heavens and the earth, the difference between the day and night, there are signs for those who ponder, those who have intellect. And he recited the entire 10 ayat. So it shows that when you receive ayat like this, when you read ayat like this, you want to think about it. You want to allow it to touch your heart, to affect you and to move you moment at the moment. And then allow it for them to have a long-term effect. But if it does not have that short-term effect, it will not have that long-term either. So we have to allow the Quran to touch us at that moment, while we're reading. And we have to try to serenade ourselves with it, build that relationship to it. And now we look at the companions of the Prophet ﷺ and how they learned from the Prophet ﷺ. The companions used to compete in who would recite the Quran the best. They used to come to him often, Ya Rasulullah, who amongst us recite the Quran the best? They used to do that very often. And the Prophet ﷺ actually sometimes used to come at night and walk between the houses and listen to them reading the Quran in the middle of the night. How many of us have that kind of relationship with the Quran? When we get up in the middle of the night, go to Hajjul and just read the Quran. But the Prophet ﷺ one time after Fajr, he turned around after Salah and said, Ya Abu Musa, he called one of the companions, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, لَقَدْ أُوتِيتَ مِزْمَارًا مِنْ مَزَانِيرِ آلِ دَاوُدْ. You have been given one of the vocal cords of Dawood alayhi salam. Because I came last night and I heard you recite the Quran. Abu Musa radiallahu anhu wa Allah said, Ya Rasulullah, if I knew you were listening to me, I would have made it even some more beautiful, just so you can enjoy it. And his entire community was known for that, subhanAllah. This is the last thing I will mention, inshaAllah. Abu Musa al-Ash'ari came from an area in Yemen. His entire tribe became Muslim. And when they actually came to Medina to learn about Islam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I know exactly where the Ash'ariyin have camped in the daytime, even though I never saw where they camped at. And the reason why is because I hear the voices of the Quran at night. So it was known that the entire tribe, imagine, they came and they pitched their tents and built houses and all that, and every single house,
You have at least one person who's up at night reading the Quran. At least one person. And they all had beautiful voices. Beautiful voices. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam actually said, Al-Ash'ariyin minni wa ana minhum. The Ash'ari tribes, they are from me and I'm one of them. Because of their connection with the Quran. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to fill our hearts with the Quran. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to move and to act and to say according to the Quran. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make the Quran an intercessor for us in the day of judgment. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who recite the Quran properly. And not only that, but act according to it. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst the people of the Quran who are the special ones. ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب. Oh Allah, do not let our hearts deviate after you have guided us and give us from within your mercy. Truly you are the sustainer. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. Our Lord, protect us in this life and protect us in the next and protect us from the hellfire. اللهم نسألك من خير ما سألك منه عبدك ورسولك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم ونعوذ بك من شر ما استعاذ بك منه عبدك ورسولك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. Oh Allah, we ask you the best that your Prophet and Messenger Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, has asked of you, and we seek refuge by you from the worst that your Prophet and Messenger Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, have sought refuge by you from. Subhanak Allahumma bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk, wa aqim as-salah.